Death at Abbey Road. Written by Rachel McLean and Millie Ravensworth. Narrated by Jan Cramer. Chapter 1. Diana Bakewell strolled along Abbey Road, her colleague Zaf Williams at her side.
"Wave to the webcam," said Zaf.
Diana gave a small smile. There was a camera trained on the zebra crossing not far from the Abbey Road studios, so people could find images of themselves crossing the road in the style of the famous Beatles album cover.
"You'd think it would cut down on road rage incidents," added Zaf, wincing as a van leaned on its horn.
A group of tourists were taking it in turns to walk halfway across the road to pose for each other's pictures. There were at least 20 of them, blocking traffic, and the drivers were becoming frustrated.
"People come from all over the world to see this crossing," said Diana. "Getting the picture they want is important to them."
Zaf nodded.
"I wonder if there's a way of timing our tour so that we can come here when the traffic is lightest.
A good point." She and Zaf were refining the details for a Beatles walking tour for Chartwell and Crouch. Until recently, the company had been mostly focused on bus tours for the many domestic and international tourists visiting London, but now the business was in such financial trouble that their vintage Routemaster buses were being sold off one by one. Privately, Diana wasn't sure even these desperate measures would be enough to stave off the company's inevitable collapse. Diana, in her mid-60s now, had been with Chartwell and Crouch for many years. She had seen the Marylebone Depot go from the strong and stable management style of Maurice Walker to the narrow-minded and penny-pinching regime of Paul Kensington. The tighter the grip he tried to keep on Chartwell and Crouch's finances, the faster the money seemed to slip through his fingers. And even young Zaf, a bright and energetic outsider from Birmingham, who had been with the company for less than 2 years, seemed to have been hit hard by the possibility of their company and jobs disappearing for good.
"People will want to go in the Abbey Road shop," said Diana, pointing to the building just beyond the studios. "There's no point getting here at the crack of dawn."
Zaf smiled. "A Beatles experience probably involves buying some memorabilia." She looked at him, then glanced at the young tourists by the zebra crossing.
"I'm surprised the Beatles still seem relevant to so many young people."
"Bit more your era," said Zaf.
"Hardly. I wasn't even at primary school when they hit the charts. They'd split up before I reached secondary school. Doesn't mean I didn't know all about them, though."
Yeah, said Zaf, waving away a familiar story. "You rented your flat off George Harrison, I know."
"My former flat. Now my mum, whom I'm obviously delighted to be sharing a flat with, she would have been a bit old for Beatlemania, but we did have their music in our house. Magical Mystery Tour, Let It Be. Well, I never.
Don't know that one."
She pointed across the road at a large square house on a corner plot off Abbey Road. This leafy part of St. John's Wood was full of large houses, from Georgian mansions to 20th century Art Deco apartment blocks. High walls and big square buildings were very much the style. It had taken Diana a moment to recognise this particular one.
"I know that building," she said. "Know it very well. Used to be Grove End Studios. Another recording studio."
The old owner insisted he hadn't set it up here to catch a bit of the Abbey Road magic. But who knows? If that was the idea, it didn't work. The place has been derelict for years.
"Well, that front bit's a cafe," Zaf pointed out.
The front left wing of the building had been converted into a cafe with a bold red, white and black frontage.
"Let It Been," he said, reading the cafe name. "Oh, I get it. That's good. And it's probably time for a cuppa, yeah?"
They crossed back over the Abbey Road zebra crossing, avoiding posing tourists and peeved London drivers.
"You know, people shouldn't tempt fate," said Diana. "That Abbey Road album cover was thought by some to be a coded message about Paul McCartney's death."
"But Paul McCartney isn't dead," said Zaf, frowning.
"You clearly don't know the crazy theory, Zaf. Paul's dead, baby. Paul's dead."
Chapter 2.
The Let It Bean Cafe had taken the Beatles theme and squeezed everything it could from it. The windows were full of memorabilia, including fake Abbey Road street signs, Beatles action figures and mugs printed with Beatles lyrics. The walls featured album covers and the menu was filled with tortured puns. It was an absorbing read, handwritten neatly on a chalkboard above the counter. I can't decide between the I want to hold your ham and cheese croissant and the I am the walnut cookie, said Zaff. Diana looked down to order some tea and recognised the man behind the counter. Oh, goodness me, Chaz! Zaff followed her gaze and pulled on a polite smile. He'd met Chaz Chase on a number of occasions. Each time the man seemed to be fulfilling a different role, taxi driver, pub landlord, etc. But whatever the occasion, Zaff was always reminded that this shaven-headed character was the hard-as-steel right-hand man to Big Ernie Holland. Both Chaz and Ernie gave off a cheery East End businessman vibe, but Zaff knew that business was as dodgy as a £7 note. They weren't men to get on the wrong side of, even if Big Ernie treated Diana like a much-loved niece.
All right, Diana, said Chaz, grinning.
It was a nice enough smile, but there was a predatory edge to it. He winked at Zaff.
Bet you're wondering why I'm here in me pinny, eh? Hadn't even crossed my mind, said Zaff. I've been branching out, restaurant business. This place hasn't been open long, but I'm getting reviews and good custom.
Diana gestured towards the neat tables and the fresh decor. I can see this becoming a magnet for tourists. I love the menu.
Dream of mine. Most of the memorabilia's from me own collection, said Chaz. Love the Beatles.
Really? Said Zaff. Chaz eyed him.
Yeah, they might have been a bunch of northern monkeys, but they made London their own. Sit down, I'll bring your stuff over.
They found a table in the window. Zaff looked over the notes they'd made for their walking tour. Abbey Road, the Cavendish Avenue house Paul McCartney bought in 65. A wander down to Marylebone Station where A Hard Day's Night was filmed. It was shaping up into a decent tour. Chaz bustled over with a tray and placed it on the table between them.
Here you go. Pot of tea for two, your croissants off, and a complimentary long and winding rocky road for each of you, freshly made.
Their tea mugs had Beatles lyrics printed on them. Diana said, All you need is love. Zaff's had, I get by with a little help from my friends, printed on it in jolly letters.
Thanks, Chaz, said Diana. It's a surprise to be back in this building, even a part of it.
Of course, said Chaz.
You recorded here, said Zaff, realising he was slow on the uptake. In the 80s, Diana had been part of a pop group, Electrobeat. They'd had one stonking hit, Count Me in 81, one hit album, and a number of so-so albums before an acrimonious split at the end of the decade.
I did, she replied. Grove End Studios is where the so-called magic happened.
Chaz slapped his sizable forehead.
I didn't tell you, did I?
Tell us what?
I don't just own the calf, I own the old place.
The whole building? Zaff wondered how much this huge old house would be worth and how deep Chaz's dodgy pockets were.
This ruin? Asked Diana with a concerned smile.
I've had it refurbed, said Chaz. All done, really. Even got your old bandmates Pascal and Ken to check it from a technical perspective. Started me own record label, La May Records, you know, sparkly and shiny. Can't believe I didn't tell you of all people. I'm having a launch party next Friday.
Oh!
I was going to get in touch with you, see if you'd attend as one of our VIP guests.
He turned to Zaff.
You're invited and all, Zaff. Bring that crowd from work. The more, the merrier.
And, said Diana, I suppose you've already invited the other band members? Chaz couldn't hold back a smile.
Ariadne. Yeah, I know she and you have got beef. I don't know if she and Pascal are even talking to each other, but she'll be there.
Zaff could see Diana trying to avoid his eye. Diana and Ariadne did not get on. They'd grown up in the East End together. As teenagers, they'd shared a flat, and they'd joined Electrobeat together. They'd even both gone into the tour guide business, albeit for different companies. So alike, but they could rarely stand each other in anything but the smallest of doses.
"We'll have all of Electra beat there," said Chas.
"Well, obviously not Morris."
"Obviously." Diana gave a sad smile. "Being in prison plays havoc with a person's social life."
"Tell me about it,"
said Chas with heavy emphasis.
"Well, anyway, we want to honour the past. We're keen to keep it authentic. You never know, there might come a time when people want to go on tours of this studio once we've made it famous again, eh?"
He looked at the album sleeve for Abbey Road on the wall above their heads, as though imagining what hit records his newly acquired studio might produce.
"Diana was telling me that this cover is a coded message about Paul McCartney's death," said Zaff.
"Of course," said Chas.
He pointed at the Fab Four on the zebra crossing.
"This is a funeral procession. John in white is a holy figure. Ringo in a suit is the undertaker. And George in his denims there is the grave digger. Paul's out of step with the rest and he's barefoot. He's the corpse." "But just to be clear, Paul isn't dead," said Zaff.
Chas gave him a look.
"For those who are prepared to see the signs, Paul's death is an absolute fact."
Zaff thought that was crazy enough to make a note of it in his pad. Chapter 3. When they returned to Chartwell and Crouch's depot in Marylebone, bus driver Newton Crombie was polishing the interior of the last remaining tour bus. Diana was certain he'd polished it the day before, but Newton was mourning its loss already. Soon enough it would be gone to a new owner. Gus, the depot cat, sat on the bus's bright red bonnet and watched his adopted human go about his sad cleaning rituals. Diana went to find Paul Kensington. She sighed and knocked on the door of his office just as her phone buzzed. It was Pascal Palmer. She was halfway in before she realised she had already answered it.
"Oh, hello, Pascal," she said.
The depot manager looked up from the box of files and office junk he was rooting through. She put up a finger to him. "One minute."
"Ah, Diana," said her old friend. "How are you?"
"Sorry, I accidentally answered while I'm at work. Can I call you back?"
Paul Kensington was frowning. In his hand, he had a key on a plastic fob, and he was turning it over as if trying to work out what it was for.
"Oh, my dear," said Pascal in his rich, deep voice, "I just wanted to check if you were going to this do at Mr. Chase's new music studio. I was planning to, because I thought you should know he also reached out to Ariadne and me."
She could read him entirely. "You're worried that if the three of us are in the same room together, there will be fireworks?
More like nuclear explosions."
She shrugged. "I'm going. I'd love to see the old place. Guess we'll have to turn up wearing our toughest armour." Paul's frown had deepened. He held up the key.
"Do you know why we have a key for Baker Street luggage drop?" "You have company," said Pascal, seeming to sense the awkwardness. "A colleague?"
"My manager. We'll speak later."
"Of course, my dear."
Diana hung up and looked at Paul.
"Paul, sorry, could I please have a word?"
Paul was still holding out the key, his eyes furiously questioning.
"No idea," she said.
He tossed the key back into the box and flipped through some papers.
"It will have to be a quick word. You can see I'm busy."
Diana had no idea how he could be truly busy. Bookings were thin on the ground, and there was increasingly little for them to do. Diana sat down on the chair in front of his desk.
"Paul, I sent you a business plan yesterday."
"Yes?"
"I think it could work to get us back on track."
"Back on track?"
She waved her hand at the depot beyond his office. In a company that seemed to be falling apart, this tiny office felt more and more like the emergency bunker of a dictator in his final days.
"Did you get a chance to look?" she asked.
Paul gave a tiny laugh and shook his head.
"Goodness me, Diana. I can't fault your enthusiasm, can I? Is there anything you won't have a go at?"
Diana forced her face to stay neutral.
"I'm sorry, Paul, but did you look at it or not?"
Paul adjusted his tie. He always wore a neatly tied tie with the short-sleeved shirts he favoured,
I'm afraid that I didn't. I'm not sure you realise how busy I am right now, Diana. It's nice of you to try and help, but you should probably stick to the things you know about, eh?
Has the fact that Chartwell and Crouch sponsored my part-time degree in business economics slipped your mind? Asked Diana.
Is that right? He said, either indifferent or oblivious. Well, that must have been before my time. I'll try and take a look. Leave it with me.
Diana had been dismissed. She stood to leave his office.
I'm sure you don't have time because you're so busy, but we've all been invited to a launch event at the new Grove End Studios in St. John's Wood next Friday. Just mentioning it, but I doubt...
Oh, that sounds fun, he said.
Yes, I think I already had an invite somewhere. It would be good. Chance for a bit of social team building.
Team building? The very notion seemed ridiculous after the man's inertia and ineptitude had all but obliterated the team. Diana left the office and closed the door behind her with a small grunt of frustration. Paul Kensington was incompetent and unrepentant. The sooner he was gone from Chartwell and Crouch, the better.
Chapter 4
Zaff walked through the quiet, tidy streets of St. John's Wood, curious about how the launch event would play out. Diana had focused on work all week and hadn't made much of the upcoming event. She was sometimes reluctant to talk about her brief spell as a chart-topping act. If Zaff had been a famous musician, he was sure he'd dine out on it for the rest of his life. Maybe, he thought as he paused across Abbey Road, this event would fill in some of the blanks in what he knew of Diana's history. Zaff had already decided that if ever an occasion demanded a vintage velvet suit in lime green, then this was the one. Months before, he'd been allowed to choose some outfits from the wardrobe of Brian, Diana's recently deceased upstairs neighbour. Brian had possibly been part of the same music scene as the Beatles and had left behind some amazing clothes. It felt right to bring Brian's suit along for the ride. The entrance to Grove End Studios was an understated door to the side of the Let It Bean Cafe. Zaff paused, then shook his head. Why wouldn't it be? This was a working building. There was a woman in a high-collared white shirt with a clipboard in the reception area. Name? She didn't look like a receptionist, mainly because she hadn't got the memo about smiling as she greeted newcomers. Zaff Williams. She made a mark on her clipboard, down the corridor and to the left. Zaff followed the instructions. The reception area had looked like the boring front offices of any sore business. But as he walked down the stark white corridor running the length of the building, he got a sudden feel for the uniqueness of this place. It might have been an old house, but it was a deep, deep building. The corridor was long enough for at least 20 framed photos of bands that had recorded here before he reached the aforementioned door. A waitress with a platter of champagne glasses nodded for him to take one and go inside. At first glance, the room beyond was much like the hall at Zaff's old primary school, large, high-ceilinged with windows only at the very top. But no school hall had microphone stands across the floor, nor an upper gallery with a large control room overlooking the hall. This is cool, he murmured. 80s synth music played softly from hidden speakers, filling the cavernous space in a way the visiting guests could not. Chaz appeared and clapped Zaff on the shoulder. Zaff, glad you could make it to the Lame Records launch. He eyed Zaff's suit.
Either you know more about fashion than I do, or you lost the bet.
My boyfriend said something similar.
Chaz looked past Zaff.
Bought in with ya?
He had all the commitments. His dad flew in for dinner.
Chaz jutted his chin.
Well, the gang's all here, he said,
gesturing at the 24 guests milling about the place.
You met my sound engineer out front.
Sound engineer?
Tracy Chen out in reception. Think she's decided to be bouncer for the evening. I don't care who turns up.
He looked over at an approaching figure.
Well, some I'd rather avoid.
He gave Zaff a curt nod and went off to greet other people. Zaff recognised the approaching figure by his white linen suit before he recognised his face. Diana had mentioned that Pascal Palmer liked to dress like the man from Del Monte, but only now did Zaff realise what that meant. Pascal Palmer, tall, regal and looking good for a man nearing 70, had been part of the Electrobeat group with Diana. But for the last 2 decades, he had been working as a restaurant critic. Zaf had met him at Diana's last birthday party, and they'd got on well, despite some confusion over Pascal's relationship with Diana. Pascal held out a small pastry confection from the buffet.
"What would you call this?" he asked.
"A vol-au-vent."
"More like a pastry bullet."
Pascal placed it on an empty table, uneaten.
"How are you doing, young sir? Love the suit."
"Thank you. This space is amazing."
Pascal raised his eyes to the ceiling.
"I'd forgotten how big this place was. Studio 2 upstairs isn't much smaller, and then Studio 3 on the top floor is a bit more intimate, possibly my favourite.
I don't think I've ever been to a proper recording studio.
Magical places. You can make anything happen here."
He turned so that he and Zaf were facing the same way, looking at the mingling guests.
"I don't know if I'm being chivalrous and making sure my ex doesn't have to meet me, or just acting like a coward."
Across the way was Ariadne Webb, talking and laughing with a circle of people. She and Pascal had been a couple, but that had ended badly many years earlier.
"That's Tom Griffin with her. You know him?"
said Pascal. "Boss of Ace Tours," said Zaf. "Nice guy, everyone says."
"I thought he was the rival to your company, driving you lot out of business."
"Oh, we don't need anyone else to help us do that," said Zaf. "Diana and Ariadne snipe at each other, but Ace Tours seems a decent company to work for."
"Ha! If that's what you think, perhaps you ought to go over and ingratiate yourself. Get yourself a new job before the bad ship Chartwell and Crouch sinks for good."
Pascal raised his glass of orange juice and pointed across the way.
"I'm going to talk to Ken, our old keyboardist. He went on the hippie trail after the band split, and I hear he has some insane notions for his next musical project."
"Oh?" Pascal smiled.
"If the rumours are to be believed, a concept album so insane it might bankrupt this studio before it's even got started. Enjoy your evening, Zaf. Nothing lasts."
With that, he crossed the studio floor and disappeared into the crowd. Chapter 5. Diana couldn't miss Saf's arrival, not with him wearing such a bright suit. She waved, but he didn't seem to see her. She was standing next to Big Ernie Holland. Big Ernie was a good few years older than her, but life didn't seem to want to slow this man down. Ernie was very much an uncle figure in Diana's life, but for all his generosity, she knew he had a darker side.
"So, how's living with your old mum?" Ernie asked.
"It's not so bad."
Ernie laughed. "I love Beverly Bakewell, but if I had to live with that tough old bird, one of us would be dead within a week."
Diana nodded. "I miss my flat, but we've settled into a sort of truce."
"Well, your stuff's in storage till you get back on your feet," said Ernie. "It can sit there for years if it needs to."
Diana smiled. Ernie had helped her with the move when she was forced out of her grand Pimlico flat in Eccleston Square. He owned the storage facility where nearly all of her possessions now resided. She had a sneaking suspicion that they would stay there until she either died or decided to get rid of them all. There was no getting back on her feet, not on a tour guide's salary. It wasn't a topic worth contemplating.
"What do you think of Chaz's new venture then?" she asked. "He looks as if he's enjoying the role of host this evening." "He's got hidden depths, has Chaz," said Ernie proudly. "Got a lot of investors in his lame records."
"I think it's pronounced lame, Ernie. I wondered if Chaz might have struggled to get respectable investors with his background."
"Who says investors are respectable?"
Ernie grinned.
"He's proper made up that you could come tonight. You and Ariadne being here years ago has given him that connection to the past that he loves. I think he said he'd found some old pictures."
"Oh, really?"
Diana wondered what pictures they might be. It was a while since she'd had any reason to think about her time here. "It's funny being back here. It hasn't changed a bit." She looked at her former bandmates. Ariadne and Pascal were keeping a wary distance from one another, avoiding each other's orbits. Beyond them, Zaf was talking to Electrobeat's old keyboard player Ken Ferrari. Between Zaf's green suit and Ken's bright pink shirt, it was hard to know which of them was the most colourful. She hadn't spoken to Ken in maybe 5 years. He'd always been so self-contained, a man fizzing with creative ideas, although not all of them good. Ariadne, Pascal, Ken.
Shame Maurice can't be here too, said Ernie.
It is.
How long has he got to serve still?
The sentence for Maurice Walker's embezzlement conviction had been all the longer for his refusal to return any of the money he had supposedly stolen.
Too long, she replied. He's not a young man now.
Ernie stretched his back, pushing his elbows out.
None of us are. You still cling to this idea he was innocent.
I do.
Ernie gave her a wry smile.
Find me a single bloke inside who won't swear on his mother's grave that he's innocent.
I'm serious, Ernie. And one day it'll come to light, you mark my words. There's just too many holes in that story. He was supposed to have set up those fake websites selling fake tickets. They were all in his name, for crying out loud. Maurice was never that daft.
Ernie nodded.
He didn't seem like an idiot, I'll give you that. But his alibi for the day he withdrew the cash from that bank.
I'm investigating that. I'm chasing down a Pomeranian dog called Marengo.
You are?
Ernie raised an eyebrow.
Well, good luck to you. I'd say that if a criminal wants money to stay hidden, it's not too hard for them to do it, if they know what they're doing. Hiding money is a dark art.
He grinned again, looking across the room at Chaz.
Do I really want to know? Said Diana.
Ernie wrinkled his nose.
No, darling, I like you sweet and innocent.
Chapter 6 Zaff found Ken Ferrari fascinating. Fascinating and possibly mentally unhinged. Ken was a stooped man in his late 60s, round-lensed specs and wispy beard lending him a mystical aura. Zaff wondered if he'd done a lot of drugs during his musical heyday. That would at least explain the weird avenue their conversation had gone down.
A cat album? He asked.
A cat album, said Ken.
Not a recording of Cats the Musical?
No, a cat album.
Ken had drawn in an audience including Newton Crombie, Paul Kensington, Pascal Palmer and Tom Griffin from Ace Tours.
Newton here tells me you have a cat down at your depot, said Ken.
He's not an official cat, replied Paul Kensington, an unwanted tenant.
People love cats, said Ken. People spoil their cats rotten. I love my Captain Smudgeson.
Captain Smudgeson? Repeated Tom Griffin with a smile.
I love him, said Ken. You can get them videos where it's like an hour of birds on a ledge, or you can have them play a game where they pat the wiggly goldfish on an iPad to score points.
Newton's done all that for Gus, said Zaff.
Right. Well, here's the thing. I'm not sure anyone's ever made a whole album of songs for cats. For cats and by cats. Because some of them are quite vocal and all, aren't they? I reckon it would be a runaway success.
His grinning face told Zaff he was convinced he'd hit on a winning formula. But Zaff wasn't so sure. So is it for cats or by cats? Asked Tom. They sound like two different things.
Nah, it's definitely both. It's a concept album, see?
Concept album, right.
Oh, no, said Paul imperiously. Recording albums is so passé. You should be renting this space out to people who record podcasts.
Ah, in the business, are you, mate? Asked Ken.
A related field, replied Paul.
Tourist tours a related field? Asked Tom.
Paul gave him a look. It's all entertainment.
Ken was ignoring him. So I reckon you should bring your cat along, Newton.
Bring Gus? Said Newton, clearly intrigued.
Ken nodded vigorously. We can get some samples off him. Make it worth his while with catnip.
I think you should get involved, Newton, said Zaff. It might distract Newton from the loss of his buses. Newton frowned. You should set up some sessions with Gus, absolutely, Zaff continued. He could be a recording star. No, I think you've got it wrong, said Paul. Podcasts, voiceovers, music recording is dead.
Ken gave a sharp laugh. Music never dies, mate. It's what makes us human. And recording music, that's capturing dreams, freezing them in a moment. The stories this building could tell. The other week, I pointed Pascal towards some old demo tapes of ours I found in Studio 3. One listened to them and the man was transported. Transported.
No, hear me out, Paul continued, oblivious to the man's passion. I've got some ideas I want to put your way, if you'll excuse us.
He put his arm around Ken's shoulder and steered him away.
Now, I'm working on this great little enterprise called the Londinumarium, and I've recently got some high-level funding for...
Surf, Newton and Tom Griffin watched him go.
Your boss, began Tom.
He's a complete twonk, said Newton.
Tom frowned. I try not to speak ill of the competition.
Oh, please do, said Zaff. He's a constant thorn in our sides. The sooner he dies, the better, added Newton.
Zaff was about to contradict his colleague, but at that moment his phone rang, his boyfriend Alexei.
Excuse me, he said to Tom and Newton, I need to take this.
He stepped away and put the phone to his ear.
Hello?
There was swirling static on the line punctuated with fractions of speech.
Alexei, Zaff said, I can't hear you.
He moved to the centre of the room. The swirling was still there. He stepped out into the corridor.
Hello? Bad signal.
The unfriendly woman from the front door was calling to him down the corridor. Tracy Chen.
Sorry?
Said Zaff.
It's a very bad signal in this area, she explained. Go upstairs and out on the fire escape.
What? The fire escape. It's safe, or go on the roof. Maybe less safe.
Zaff hesitated. Tracy gave an exasperated sigh and came marching down the corridor. She gestured for him to follow her up to the first floor, where she pointed at a door that led through to an external metal staircase. The call to Alexei had dropped, but Zaff went out onto the fire escape anyway. It was one of those zigzagging metal staircases. The steps clanged under his feet as he climbed, and he wondered why it always felt precarious on stairs where you could see through the gaps. He tried to call Alexei again.
Hello?
Ah. Finally, I can hear you, said Alexei. Where are you?
Zaff was almost at the top.
I'm on the roof of Grove End Studios, looking out over Abbey Road from up high.
Yeah? Can you see anything interesting?
Mostly I can see the tops of trees and the chimneys of houses.
Didn't the Beatles do a concert at the top of Abbey Road Studio?
Asked Alexei.
No, that was at Savile Row, on top of the Apple building. That's the Apple Record Company, not the other one.
One of the things I like about you, you know a lot of fun facts, said Alexei.
Diana and I have been working on a Beatles walking tour.
Alexei sighed. He'd suggested to Zaff that if his days at Chartwell and Crouch were numbered, he should divert his energy into finding an alternative.
I should get back to the party, said Zaff. Aren't you having dinner with your dad?
We finished early. We came to an arrangement.
Oh?
Another sigh. Alexei's father, Cameron Dadashov, owned significant engineering and property interests in every country between here and his native Azerbaijan. Most of the time it was a long-distance relationship, and it hadn't been an easy one of late.
He asked me to apologize, said Alexei.
For what?
For everything. For you.
For me?
For taking your side in the business over the Eccleston Square House, for, in his words, flouncing off like a rebellious tin. He did not mince his words.
I thought you said you'd reached an agreement.
It was possibly one-sided, said Alexei.
Zaff could hear sadness in his voice.
I told him he didn't need to come to London to see me ever again until he was ready to apologize and treat me like the adult I am.
Oh, man, said Zaff. He's your dad. Don't do this for me.
I'm not doing it for you,
Alexei replied.
Well, I'm doing it for us. That's it. Ties cut. I'll just have to cope as a penniless dilettante socialite in London.
With a luxury Thames apartment and a squillion in savings.
It's a tough life.
Alexei gave a pretend tearful sniff. Zaff smiled. I love you.
Good, said Alexei. I'm kind of banking on that.
But he is your dad. Don't let something like this hang over you. He won't be around forever, and we can't rebuild relationships once someone has gone.
I know, said Alexei. Anyway, I wondered if there was any point in me coming down to your party.
Absolutely. There's actual B-list pop stars here. Super kitsch.
I'll jump in the cab.
The call over. Zaff looked across the city. A sky of red and pink was settling across West London. He drank it in for a moment, then went back down the fire exit. There were fire doors leading off from the second and first floor, but only the first floor one was open. he returned to the warmth of the studio building. The night air was turning chilly.
Chapter 7.
Diana hadn't hesitated when Chaz suggested that people...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.